Good morning, everyone. Welcome to CSL Palm Desert. My name is Dr. James Mellon, and I'm here to welcome you to today's service. As many of you know, Dr. Joe has retired and gone off to Fort Lauderdale, Florida to create a brand new life for himself. And in the interim, I will be here to bring us all through this experience of COVID and into this brand new world. So today's celebration, we have Doug and Megan singing for you. And oh my God, they are just amazing. You are going to have an amazing time today. So sit back, relax, and here you go. You get to be inspired. Namaste.
What's happening this week at the center? Today at 12:30, join Reverend Dale Olansky for her program, Spirit of Women. Find fellowship, support, and growth with Reverend Dale and the guest speaker she invites to take all that attend to their highest and best good. Click on the banner on the homepage for all the details to join. Monday, Dr. James Mellon continues the class at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, featuring Raymond Hollowell's book, Working with the Law. This week, the Law of Non-Resistance. Are you unknowingly creating resistance resistance to the good in your life, make sure to mark your calendar and then join Dr. James at 10 a.m. Monday. Tuesday, Reverend Gail Morton leads her class, Grief and Loss as Initiation. A certified counselor in grief, Reverend Gail, in this virtual Zoom class will gently guide you and be there on the other side. Her class begins at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, Tuesday, March 23rd. On Wednesday, it's All for One, and this week's topic of discussion is the duality inherent in beauty. Is there such a thing as duality? If we describe light, is the opposite automatically thought of by default? Join the staff ministers as they peel this question back layer by layer. It all begins at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, Wednesday. Thursday, Dr. Laura continues her book study from the book, The Dynamic Laws of Healing. Take control and tap into your power to heal. If you enjoy learning through book studies, then this class is a must. Dr. Laura and the attendees read and then discuss the book together to expose its full value through the group. The healing begins at 10 a.m. Thursday morning. Saturday, join us at 10 a.m. for a 30-minute journey through a guided meditation with one of our staff ministers. It goes live at 10 a.m. Saturday morning and then remains on demand throughout the day. As we turn down the noise of the outside world, the inside can grow, heal, and find inspiration from the universe. Please join us, won't you? For these and other offerings, we invite you to go to the website at cslpalmdesert.org and click on the banners or the calendar for all that is happening at the center.
Good morning. Now it's time for our mission statement. We are a dynamic, open, positive faith community that accepts all religions. Our mission is to awaken you to your divine nature, empowering you to create the life of your dreams. We are changing lives, one heart at a time. Oh, wasn't that wonderful? And now it's time to relax, to settle into that space of knowing, allowing us to just embody what life is. So at this time, I invite you to relax as we head into meditation.
Get ready, my soul. I'm diving in. Get ready, my soul. I'm diving in to the deepest kind of love, to the sweetest kind of life. Get ready, get ready, my soul. Everything I've ever done and everything I've ever seen, everything I've lost or won, and everything I've ever dreamed has brought me here to this present moment here, to this new beginning here, and I'm seeing life so clear now. Get ready, my soul. I'm diving in. Get ready, my soul. I'm diving in to the deepest kind of love, to the sweetest kind of life. Get ready. soul. Get ready, get ready, my soul.
And now, this is what I know. That there is just one life. That life is God's life. It is the embodiment of the expression of the one self. And I recognize my unity with that one source. And I know that my life is the expression of spirit. My life is the fulfillment of that one life, that one love. My life is purposeful. I love, cherish every expression of the divine spirit. I allow that love to guide me, to lead my thoughts, always with the focus of love. And as I live my life from that standpoint, I know that that love radiates out to others and allows that divine light to express itself, to recognize that we are all just one thing happening, and that is the expression of spirit in action. And so now I give great thanks, knowing the truth, the divine truth of life, and I live from that divine life. With gratitude in my heart, I now release my word as law, as we all say together, and so it is.
Show me the way. Show me the way. Your love will light my way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Your joy. Your joy will light. Will light my way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Your peace. Your peace. Will light. Will light. My way. My way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Your truth, your truth will light, will light my way. And your love, your love will light, will light my way. My way. And your joy, your joy will light, will light my way.
Shanti Om, Shanti Om, Shanti Om.
Those of you who have been here before know what this is all about. This is our offertory basket. And while we can't gather together here in person to receive your financial gifts, we can definitely reach out to you virtually. You can send your gifts to us by phone through text, or you can go to our website and give a gift through PayPal, or you can drop by an envelope with some cash or a check, or you can call us with a credit card. There's many ways you can give. And I just want to take a moment of gratitude. Gratitude for you, because you allow our center to thrive, to be able to have wonderful people that serve our center, that allow everything to happen in the background, and you don't even know all that is supporting you here at our center. And your financial gifts are so appreciated, because you know we can't do it without you. So please take a moment and just know in your heart what would be a good gift for you to give to us today, and choose whichever method you want to give your gift. And so just join me in a prayer around this, just knowing that everything is energy in motion, everything. And money too is spirit in motion. And today is a time to honor and give back that which you have received through our inspiration, through our music, through anything that has lifted you today. And so as we open up our hearts to give what is on our mind and our heart to give, I am so grateful just to know that as we give, so we receive. And the universe being so expansive, the more that we give, the more we receive, and the greater our life becomes. And so with gratitude in my heart for all who are participating in the law of reciprocity, and just know how very blessed you are for giving to us, we bless you tenfold for all you are giving us today. So thank you for giving, and we appreciate you so much.
Hello, I'm Dr. Laura Shackford, Center for Spiritual Living, Palm Desert. But as you can see, I am not at the Center for Spiritual Living, Palm Desert. I am so blessed, and you are so blessed. I am here at our Founders Church here in Los Angeles, and we are so blessed. There's such history here, and it's so amazing. And we have an incredible speaker. We have a great treat for you. We have the legendary, amazing Dr. Arthur Chang that is going to give you an inspirational talk today on principles of success. You don't want to miss this for anything. And I'm over the moon over this. And I know you will be too when you hear this incredible talk.
Hello, Fred. Today I want to share with you a topic I am calling the gifts of a positive life. We've all heard about being positive. And I think those of us who have gone to do something for the first time and have failed at it because we were so nervous and negative about our capabilities can really align themselves with this topic. I think William James really touched upon it well when he says, "The greatest discovery of my generation is that a human being can alter his life by altering his attitudes." When I say attitude, I mean consciousness. We hear that word more often today than we hear attitude. But it's the same thing. It's the consciousness. It is how we come to embody a feeling that we are fine in this world. We're okay in this world. We are here to do what it is we are here to do, and we are supported by a very generous universe that is back of us. I think somehow or other, from our meditation and our prayer, we'll begin to develop that notion. But no matter how we feel inspired when we start some object, some particular task, there are always going to be someone to discourage us. There's always going to be a detractor. Have you had that experience? I've had that experience. And what you really need to understand is this old proverb that says, sticks and stones are only thrown at fruit-bearing trees. Now, you think about that. You know, when I was a boy growing up in Jamaica, we'd be coming home from lunch and there would be these huge mango trees in people's yards. And of course, we would go get some sticks and stones and we would see that ripe mango up there. And believe me, I don't know how some of us didn't become American pitchers to play baseball, but we didn't play baseball, unfortunately. And we would get that stone and we would throw up into that tree. And if we hit that mango and it dropped on the ground, we'd dash inside. I don't know if I'm confessing or what it is, but the idea is whenever you're doing something fruitful, people will notice it. And some people will not be kind toward you. But you have to overcome that. You have to get over it and recognize that you're not doing this for somebody. You're doing this for you. And why can you do this? Because when you are positive, you will bring out the best that is inside of you. In the science of mind, we like to think that back of our thoughts is the law of mind in action. Kind of long term to say that your thinking is really connected to spiritual laws, mental laws. And once you begin to understand that, you will realize that you are the one who is generating how the law works for you. Because if you're negative, it will work negatively for you. And if you're positive, it will work positively for you. So if you, for example, want to achieve something, but you don't believe you can achieve it, the tendency is that the law is still working, but it is working against what you believe. It's working by appearing not to work because you do not believe it. We see examples of this in Jesus' teachings and his interaction with people, that he will say to the centurion, for example, be it done unto you as you believe. Why? Because you are embodying the way you see the world and the way you will act in the world. It doesn't mean that just because you believe something, it just plops in front of you. If you have that notion, I can tell you that poor people would be having a lot of money in front of them, but that doesn't happen, does it? No. The belief must be embodied in a way where it begins to work through your actions and that the things that you do are in accordance with that belief. And once you do that, you are on your way to a winning life. One of the hardest things to do is to listen to the statement of Jesus when he says, judge not by appearances, but judge righteous judgments. How can you not judge by appearances, you might ask? For example, when we see COVID and people losing their jobs, and when we see that there are people who don't believe that they should mask or distance or do any of the things that scientifically has been proven to be helpful, what do you do? Well, you still wear your mask. You still have your social distancing. You still wash your hands. Why? Because you're not working superstitiously. You're working with principles. And the principles work whether they're, we call them spiritual principles or scientific principles. All principles come from the one source, which is God. All principles come from the one united infinite mind that is working through each one of us. So when we say, do not judge by appearances, but judge righteous judgment, is you can look at the negative things that are happening and look for the good possibilities that are there too. So every single negative experience is really an experience that has within it this innate goodness that can come from it. But you have to see it. So we see that some people had just recently, the power goes out from, say, Texas, for example, it might lead people to think about how they allow one group of people to have the power that is not controlled by some central governmental control. Whether they decide to do that or not, it's up to them. But the idea is that they will have to look for new possibilities. What if this happened? Now that they see what can happen. Now, what about people who are out of jobs with COVID? It may be a time for you to reassess what it is that you're doing and to see what new things will be in demand as things change for you. For example, we can see what the new governmental policies are, where they're going, and see how you can align yourself to that wonderful sense that you can flow into something new. Maybe you don't want to go back to what happened before. You know, the idea is if you become depressed by the negative, then what you're doing is you're closing the possibilities of your life because you can't see them. You're putting blinders on your eyes. You're putting a glass that is impervious to possibilities. And instead of coming spiritually to a situation, you are finding yourself doing just the reverse. No wonder then that Winston Churchill, the former great Prime Minister of England, once said, "The pessimist sees the difficulty in every situation. The optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty." And this is truly what we have. We have people who are leaders. Why? Because they can find new ways of doing things. They can say, okay, this is where I this is how I see it. This is where I am. But here's what I have. And they will start working with that. So at all times, you must understand that it's not about being perfect. It's not about scoring each time at everything that you try. For example, in baseball, a batter who gets a hit 3 out of 10 times he has an opportunity to hit is headed for the Hall of Fame. In other words, he has failed 7 times to get a hit in the opportunities that he has had, in the 10 opportunities. But he's headed for the Hall of Fame. We think of the great Michael Jordan, for example, who always hit that great basket at the end of the game. And if you look at what really happened, in fact, Jordan has missed more of those opportunities than he has made them. But yet he's the greatest basketball player in the world, or at least in my opinion. So what am I saying? I'm saying that life is not requiring you to be perfect, to be successful, and to be very good. You can be on the top of your game because you are doing more things and you're positively engaging the challenges that you have in life, realizing that there are simply more opportunities for you to look at life differently and, as they say, think outside the box. If you're like the Apple company, you can see how they have come up with new products each time. And when you come up with a new product, you're ahead of the field. And that is really what we need to do with our own personal lives too. Look at the talents that you have. Look at the gifts that you have. Look at what you really love to do. And if you have been in a boring job all this time, as we get ready to get back to work and for the economy to start flowing again, look at how you want to fit into it. And if you begin to embody a feeling of how you want to fit in it, it becomes part of the way the law of mind in action is working for you. And before you know it, you will find opportunities opening up to you that you didn't even realize existed. We look at a tennis star. Of course, Serena Williams, for example, and she doesn't win all her matches. but she's one of our greatest female tennis star. Why? Because she stuck with it. She loses some matches, but she wins more than she loses. Do not worry about losing things. Do not be afraid to fail, because it is in our failure that we learn best how to be the success that we can be. But a person who is experiencing a losing consciousness is a person who will use that experience of having lost at something to just close themselves off from the possibilities of life. The real winner, the positive person, will say, okay, so this didn't work. Like Edison, I know 1,000 ways that this invention won't work, so I'll move on and try another. That is the winning mind. That is the positive mind, and you're capable of it. One of the things that we really need to do is to recognize that we are capable of much more than we think. And one of the ways in which we do that is to lean on our intuition. Lean on our intuition. How do we do that? The way you do that is you do the prayer work, you do the meditation, you take long walks into nature. You kind of lose yourself into the question, what is my best life? What is my best way to do this? Have you ever had that? You lose yourself into that best life. And you stay with the question. As Rilke says, live the question. And when you are open to asking the question, what is my best way of coming out of this challenge? Suddenly, in the most unexpected time, because you're positive, and because it means you're open, your vessel is ready to receive, suddenly here comes the answer. And you had no idea. Einstein points out that it's not his reason and his rationality and his knowledge that gave him the greatness he had. It's his intuition. He had this sense of God's thought. I want to know the thought of God. The rest is immaterial. The rest is just details. That's really where you are, just as he was. But you have to be positive about it. Let me tell you some of the real challenges you will have for being negative. Let's see what the gifts are. People who are negative do what they call, what psychology call filtering. And this is, they pull out the negatives out of every situation and focus on the negative. They're filtering out all the bad things. There are good things there, but they don't take out the good thing. They take out the bad thing. Psychology call it filtering. They talk about personalizing. They make every tragedy be about themselves. It's all about me. You're talking about something, it turns to them. And they portray themselves in a very poor way as a result of thinking that way. Psychology talks about polarizing. And this kind of negative thinker thinks he sees everything in black and white. It's either good or it's bad. There's no sense of gray. There's no sense of that, gee, you have to make little steps to get something. It's either successful or it's a failure. And you have to watch being polarized. So these are four things that negative people tend to do. But here is something that we find in business that is done that is helpful. It's called a SWOT analysis, SWOT. And what is it? S is for strength, W is for weaknesses, O is for opportunities, and T is for threats. Businesses will do this. And so they look, when they're going to take on some kind of challenge, they look at what their strengths are. That is positive. But you might say, Dr. Arthur, if somebody's looking at the weaknesses, isn't that negative? No. No, it's not negative. You look at what your weaknesses are. You look at what is it that you don't do well. And why is it not negative? Because you're simply describing your situation. You're not affirming it. You're not saying, I'm going to be weak. You look at what your weaknesses are so you know what you need to do to take care of to be impactful at what you're doing. So you have the strength, you have the weaknesses, and then you have opportunities. You ask yourself, what are the opportunities that are out there? Like in this new economy that we're going into, what are the opportunities? They're going to be building bridges. They're going to be building all kinds of systems. They're going to be moving into electricity and all that stuff. I'm not sure where you are with all this, but there will be things that are generated as a result of that. Opportunities are going to abound. People who make restaurants need to know where to put the restaurants. People who have plays and music and all those things will see that once we begin to stir around with a more flourishing economy, all these things will be needed. That's what it means by opportunities. But also the opportunity for what it is that you're doing to succeed. And then they look at threats. Again, you might ask, isn't that negative? No. No, if you're going to have an affair and there's going to be a storm or something that's going to happen on that day as is predicted by the weather person, weather man, weather woman, you might want to not do it on that date because that's a threat. So whatever it is that might be a threat to you, you must be aware of it. And you must be prepared positively to deal with it. So, how can you use your mind more positively? Jesus gives us many, many hints, but in this particular case, he says you must have faith as a mustard seed, and if you do, you'll be able to say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. Is that really true? Can you say to a mountain, move from here to there, and nothing will be impossible for you? I think one of the things that we need to understand about spirituality is that Jesus is a poet, and we don't need to take everything literal that he says. We need to see it symbolically. What is that mountain that stands in your way of being positive and engaging your life in such a way that you can achieve your dreams? It's your belief. That's the mountain. That mountain stands in your way, and you need to be able to tell that mountain, move from here to there. The physical mountain has nothing to do with your living the life you need to live. That is part of the geography you're living within. You can't tell the earth to move from here to there and go to a different solar system. So we're not saying that faith works in that way. We're saying faith works in a personal way, where it seems like you're believing that the economy is bad. I can't get to where I'm going to go. And you have to stop thinking that way and start saying, but I will find a way to make what I need to do work well. And once you are of that mindset, that becomes that seed idea that is going to grow. It doesn't necessarily grow overnight, but if you have that seed idea, you will find it growing. So think of many of the sayings in the scripture as symbolic language of what it is that you need to know inside yourself to bring out that greatness that is within you that can remain dormant because you think that you just can't do what you need to do. So, what can we do? We can plant a positive seed in mind. We must nurture that positive seed idea with prayer and mindfulness. We can then realize that the law of mind in action is working on our dream and is moving even when we do not see anything happening, moving to that point where things are unfolding in the invisible, but it is going to happen because you believe in it. You will look at the many people who seem to have failed and come back, and you will see that what they have in common is that when they have been coming out of failure, it is because they had this positive belief that there is something within me that is greater than I am, and they were using it. They're really just examples of a greatness that is within you as well. You should not see yourself as an exception or see them as an exception, but see them as an example of what you yourself can be. We must make a demand upon the law if we want the law to respond. Let me finally give you 7 health benefits of being positive in life. These are 7 gifts that you will get. You will increase your lifespan. Is that something of interest to you? I think most of us are interested in this. You will lower your rate of depression. That happens as a result of psychological study. You will lower your levels of distress. You will have greater resistance to the common cold. You will have better psychological and physical well-being. You will have better cardiovascular health and reduce the risk of death from cardiovascular disease. And the final one is you will have better coping skills during hardships and times of stress. I think these are worthwhile things on a personal level to get. But in addition to this, you will be able to fulfill the dreams of your life. God bless.
So let's end this service with a prayer. Please get comfortable. Open your hearts to receive. So this is what I know. I know that it is all God, it is all good. There is that oneness in life, that creative energy, that loving energy, that pure love that soars through me and soars through each and every one of us. Each one of us is one with it. We are that perfect, unique expression of the divine, of spirit, of God, of that universal intelligence. And knowing that this is true, we recognize and claim our good right here and right now, knowing that all is well, knowing that everything within our body is in perfect harmony and alignment, knowing that our lives are unfolding because spirit is listening to our command, and our command is wholeness, love, prosperity, the goodness, the joy of life. And so we live it to the fullest, knowing that spirit is there, spirit is guiding us, spirit is leading us by our order for joy, our order for prosperity, our order for health and wholeness. So I am so grateful for this teaching, for this center that teaches these spiritual principles, that opens our heart every day, every moment, that awareness that life is good, life is very good. So I know that this is the truth. Therefore, I release my word as the law, knowing that it is done, knowing that it is so. And please join me as we say together, and so it is. Have a very blessed weekend, everyone, and a wonderful week.